Buenos días a todos. Mi nombre es Gabriela López. Soy Portfolio and Program Manager de Educación Superior en McGraw-Hill Education. Estoy muy contenta de estar aquí con todos ustedes, justamente recibiendo la visita del Dr. Yunus Schenkel a esta conferencia que nos comparte con toda su experiencia y todo su conocimiento. Voy a leer su semblanza para dar la bienvenida al Dr. Schenkel posteriormente. Yunus Schenkel es profesor emérito de la Universidad de Nevada, Reno, en Estados Unidos, y decano fundador de la Facultad de Ingeniería de la Universidad Adnan Menderes de Aydın, Turquía. Se doctoró en Ingeniería Mecánica en la Universidad Estatal de Carolina del Norte, en Estados Unidos. Antes de incorporarse a la ADU en 2012, ocupó el cargo de decano de la Facultad de Ingeniería Mecánica de la Universidad Técnica de Yildiz y de asesor del presidente del Consejo de Investigación Científica y Tecnológica en materia de cooperación internacional. El profesor Schenkel fue subdirector y director del Centro de Evaluación Industrial de la UNR durante 8 años. También ha sido asesor de varias organizaciones gubernamentales y empresas privadas sobre la eficiencia energética, políticas energéticas y reforma educativa. El profesor Schenkel es el autor o coautor de los libros de texto ampliamente adoptados, entre ellos Thermodynamica and Engineering Approach, Fundamentos de las Ciencias Térmicas y de los Fluidos, Transferencia de Calor y Masa, Fundamentos y Aplicaciones, Mecánica de Fluidos, Fundamentos y Aplicaciones, Ecuaciones Diferenciales para Científicos e Ingenieros, Fundamentos y Aplicaciones de las Energías Renovables, y Eficiencia y Gestión de la Energía para Ingenieros. Todos ellos publicados por McGraw-Hill, algunos de sus libros de texto se han traducido al chino, japonés, coreano, tailandés, español, portugués, turco, italiano, griego y francés. Ha recibido varios premios a profesores destacados y el premio Merriam Wiley Distinguished Author de la ASEE en 2 ocasiones. Es un ingeniero profesional registrado en el estado de Nevada, Estados Unidos. Pues dejo con ustedes al Dr. Yunus Schenkel y agradezco muchísimo la atención que nos ha brindado al proporcionarnos esta conferencia para todos nuestros queridos profesores y estudiantes. Bienvenido, doctor.
Good morning, how are you? Okay, let me share the presentation. Okay, I assume you can see the presentation, right? Okay, good morning, correct. Everybody. Buenos dias, and I hope you are doing well. And it's a pleasure to be here. I know I am with you through the books, many of you, so we are spending a lot of time together actually, but this is a kind of face-to-face chat, nothing serious. We will just talk about some energy, some artificial intelligence, and hopefully we will have a chance in the future to meet in person in your country, be it Mexico, Guatemala, Colombia, I don't know, Ecuador, other places. Okay, today I will be discussing the integration of energy with artificial intelligence, okay? I will simply emphasize 3 words. One is artificial intelligence, the other is integration, and the third one is simplicity. If you remember these 3 words at the end, that means I think you got the basics from this presentation here. So artificial intelligence, integration, and simplicity. And the reason is right now artificial intelligence is the cross-cutting and enabling technology. We see it everywhere. And integration is the name of the new game. If you cannot integrate the cross-cutting technologies as engineers, then you fall behind. And right now, AI is being integrated into everything, artificial intelligence. And simplicity is still very important. So let me start with this example, the iPhone. I'm sure some of you remember 2007, iPhone was introduced by Steve Jobs. And now let's ask the question, what really was new with the iPhone? It was a new product, but did iPhone bring any new technology? Probably not. It had wide screen. We have computers with larger screens, touchpad. We had iPads with no keys, so it was working just fine. Cell phone, internet, camera, all existed. Okay, then what made the difference in iPhone? iPhone integrated all of these technologies, okay, in one product. That is the integrating the existing technologies or components into one device made all the difference. And the entire, sector changed, the iPhone industry. And Nokia was the king at the time. And then Nokia, BlackBerry, et cetera, they had a hard time. So integration is very important. The other thing which is very important is simplicity. For example, 15 years ago, people were asking if the future is hydrogen cars or electric cars. And my position was it would be electric. Why? Many advantages, but because it is simpler. No moving parts. Hydrogen is complicated, okay? And with electric, you already have the electricity in your house. So you don't need another hydrogen line, or you don't have to go to a charging station if you live in a city there. So just the basic thing of simplicity made the difference. And of course, the cost of batteries came down to one-tenth. So today what we have is really no competition. That is in car industry, it is clearly electric cars, and hydrogen is out of the race right now. It may have a place in large transportation vehicles like airplanes, maybe trains, ships, and maybe trucks, okay? And right now we are communicating through Zoom. And if you remember in the past, we had some programs and Skype was the most famous. How come then Zoom is most common right now? Again, simplicity. It is intuitive, user-friendly, okay? And that makes all the difference. That is, technology is good, okay? And sophistication is good, but simplicity makes all the difference. On integration, okay, let me give you this example. It will help us to warm up. Now, what you see here is a car. Okay, what is the difference? It has solar cells, PV cells all over the roof, okay? So it generates its energy. If you leave this car under the sun during the day, it will store enough electricity for you to drive like 45 kilometers, which is not bad. That is, you can drive probably, to work and back home using this charge here, if you park in a sunny place when you are at work there. So the technology is certainly very attractive, right? But the problem is, look at the aesthetics. Would you want to drive in this car? It doesn't look very pretty, right? So the aesthetics will make the difference. That is kind of blend the PVs into the design of the car such that it looks like it doesn't have any PVs, okay? That is, the photovoltaics are invisible. It looks like, nice, sleek, beautiful car. If you can do it, then I think the product will be successful. Otherwise, I don't think people will buy this. It is technologically sound. It is energy efficient. It is good for your pocket, but the looks makes you some difference there. Okay, artificial intelligence. It is the new platform of things. That is, no matter what you buy nowadays, even some simple toys, okay, it has AI. And if it doesn't, then it is automatically a dinosaur. That is, it is like, you know, it doesn't belong to this age here. I think no matter what you are manufacturing, you are producing, somehow you will have to incorporate artificial intelligence, small or big. And you will have to let some decisions to be made by AI. Again, the amount will depend on the product, the sophistication, whatever. And nowadays, the data literacy, it is becoming very important. Using the data, I think, again, generating the data, making sense out of the data is making all the difference. I will discuss those in a few minutes there. And you know, smart devices are not really very far. Our cell phone, the computer, let's say the gadgets like Amazon Alexa, you may have one, you know, in your house, Apple Siri, Microsoft Cortana, or Google Assistant, they are really AI. They are helping us to be more productive, doing some routine things. And whatever we are doing, they help us do it very fast. And they help us to be more effective, efficient, and productive. The tools, we never replace human beings, okay? Especially engineers, we are very valuable. But these are tools, they help us. They help us to be more productive, better, and more efficient there. For example, being a doctor is a very safe profession. That is, machines will never replace human doctors. But the AI will make them more accurate and more efficient, and often it will save lives. Example, Google, you know, developed this deep learning algorithm. Okay, and it fed in like several millions of x-rays so that the machine can differentiate between an x-ray which has a tumor and x-ray which is, you know, no tumor, the person is healthy. Kando, you know, learned those things, what shape, you know, is cancer and what is not. And what we do as a doctor is really similar. We look at, let's say, the x-ray. And in our mind, as a doctor, we know how tumors look like in our mind. We compare. If there is a match, we make the diagnosis. If they say we don't see any tumors, we say the person is healthy. The funny thing is, the machine is more accurate than human doctors. Okay, it is like the Google AI. The accuracy rate is 94%. Which is, I think, higher than many doctors. Does it mean that, you know, in the future, the machines will read the x-rays? No. I think if I were a doctor, would it be my enemy? No. I would buy it and use it. And I look at the x-ray, no cancer. Google AI looks at the x-ray, no cancer. Now I feel confident. I can tell with confidence to the patient that, you know, you are fine. But if they say, I look at the x-ray, I don't see anything. And Google AI says, I see cancer. Then I put my glasses, I look at it again very carefully. Okay. And the patient will benefit from this. Such gadgets will help doctors to be better and also to save more lives there. And nowadays, you know, when you apply for credit card, people may not even see it. That is, the AI is making the decision. You apply for a loan or something, okay? And people are sometimes involved in, let's say, more serious cases, but most work is done by the AI. That way, the loan officers can process, you know, a lot of requests, and it saves really hours because the routine things are done, even routine decisions are done by AI there. And you remember, right now, you also see the news that autonomous cars are coming. I think in this decade, we will see autonomous vehicles. Tesla they have, you know, autonomous cars to a certain degree, but in the future, the airplanes, you know, helicopters, I don't know, cars, trains, ships, whatever, we will have, you know, they will have no drivers or captains engineers there, because the autonomous driving will be firmly in place. Therefore, if you are planning to be a pilot, probably you should think again. You may not be needed, you know, in 5 or 10 years there. And right now, you know, we have smart homes. Okay, everything is being connected. It is not fully smart yet, but we are getting there. And we talk about smart cities, and we have some demonstrations on smart cities. And here, what is happening is cities, everything in the city, they interconnect the homes to each other, transportation, energy, infrastructure, health and security systems, and everything that can be connected. And they work together, okay? So the entire city works like an organism. And of course, for us engineers, most important is industry for all. It is simply the old industry, which is, you know, automation, robots, whatever, plus Internet of Things, that is interconnected. All the devices are right now interconnected, okay? And not only that, they are also connected with people. That is, some decisions are made by the machines, AI, some by human, some together. Let's say some order is taken, okay? The machine will take the order. Maybe we'll order the raw material. Siemens, for example, is doing a lot of this right now. The companies that do this, obviously they'll be more advanced, more profitable, and faster, okay, in developing a product there. Many things will be decided without any human involvement, okay? It will speed up things, and it will bring efficiency. And of course, in this environment, when things are, you know, artificial, done by artificial intelligence, the machines are talking to each other, then the human beings also should be able to survive in this environment, okay? And so Industry 4.0 is a German invention, and Japanese came up with, you know, Society 5.0. It is like the people need to be, you know, one step ahead of the machines. It means that human beings should be functional and effective in this new environment. In this environment where everything is interconnected, okay? And many decisions are being made by artificial intelligence. And the World Economic Forum, they did a survey a few years ago, and they asked for the skills of the people to be functional in this Industry 4 environment, okay? This is not for engineers, but really for anybody. And here are the top 10 responses. The first one is critical thinking, okay? That is to really look at something and kind of examine it and see how it can be made a better, you know, pass judgment. Kind of, you know, can you be, let's say, can you evaluate something critically? Okay, this is a human trait. The machines cannot do it. They do other things. Critical thinking requires thinking out of the box. And then creativity. See, we have imagination. We can imagine anything. The machines cannot do that. And our creativity, all the new products that we come up with, it comes with imagination, with our creative power. Okay, the machines do not have it, cannot have it. They are simply machines. Okay, imagination is, you know, something human there. So if you have a creative mind, certainly you are a valuable person. And then problem solving. The machines do a lot of things, but they don't know what they are doing. They have no idea. So the complex problem solving, coming up with new solutions. Again, it makes us engineers really unique. And managing people. coordinating with others, emotional intelligence, judgment and decision making, service orientation, negotiation, cognitive flexibility, and things of this nature. Okay. And the sad thing is, you don't learn these things, you know, at school. We don't have any class that teaches that. That means you will have to acquire these skills as you go through your classes, education, whatever. Therefore, the extracurricular activities, like, you know, being active in student societies, clubs, whatever, or, you know, working together in projects, whatever, okay? And American Society of Mechanical Engineers, ASME, they also did a survey on the attributes that will help you advance as an engineer, your career. And here are the results. One is communication. That is, in this new environment, the routine things, you know, will be done by artificial intelligence, but you will have to be a good communicator, spoken or written communication. And you will have to make good presentations because you will have to, you know, be convincing, which means knowledgeable and good communication stands there. Self-confidence and humility. No one likes, you know, people who brag about themselves. And resilience. Things, you know, get tough sometimes. Now, can you be tougher and be resilient there? And empathy. Can you look at things from the eyes of other people, the customer, whatever, the society, and the brand identity? That is, do you really kind of be a special person in some way, a person who is needed? And when some expertise, some skill is needed, you come to mind. Okay, you fill some gap, okay? You create a brand. So what is the result? The result is that many routine things, routine jobs will be done by artificial intelligence, okay? Of course, then the question is, how about engineers? Keep in mind that engineering is a very creative activity. And this survey also shows that only 2% of the engineering jobs will be lost to machines. That is 98% of our jobs, okay, will be safe. Why? As I mentioned before, because we are problem solvers as engineers, we are creative people, and we excel in critical thinking there. And if, let's say, you don't really understand this reality of artificial intelligence, how the world is changing, then before you know it, you know, you may be extinct. Some of you may remember Kodak, okay? About 20 years ago, we had some you know, digital cameras, but not so advanced. So still film was very common. And Kodak was the major filmmaker, okay? And in 2013, the company went bankrupt because it couldn't adapt to the digital technology. At one time, it employed like 145,000 people. So even no matter how major you are, even if you are number one in the world, unless you adopt this new environment of artificial intelligence, digitization, okay, and, you know, using, let's say, data analytics, then you are in danger. Okay, let's look at the energy after this general remarks, okay? And now smart energy, what is it? It is really energy plus intelligence. Okay, the energy system don't have brain, so it will have to be artificial intelligence. And this is really integration. That is, you take any energy system, okay, and incorporate AI, then you have smart energy. And it is a new device, no matter what it is, because it is now smart. Many decisions are made by that device, okay? I think if, let's say, you are in the energy business and you are thinking about, let's say, what to do, instead of concentrating on a new product, of course you should do it, you should also concentrate on have to incorporate artificial intelligence into your existing products. Okay, so that, you know, your devices talk to each other, to other devices, to people, send messages, you know, a lot of things. That is, it will have to interact with people and with other devices there. And it will have to generate a lot of data, and data analytics right now. It is being, the big thing, okay? Everything from renewable energy to energy efficiency, energy storage, energy, anything. I think we will see artificial intelligence, we are seeing it anyway, okay? Incorporated in it. Even the energy management systems, okay? They will have to involve artificial intelligence, including learning, including making many decisions by themselves. Because look at the human body, okay? If let's say there are 100 decisions made in our body, okay? Probably we make, you know, 3 or 4 decisions, that's it. How about the 90 plus decisions? It looks like, you know, it is done. There is an autonomous operating system. It is done by the body itself. Okay, that is, you don't get involved in it. Somehow the body makes those decisions. We make the major decisions. Okay, which is of course important, but we have no idea how the liver operates. Okay. And the digestive system, you know, a lot of things. That is, if let's say we were also involved in that, I don't think we could survive even one day. And I think the machines, the devices will be that way. Okay, then what is smart energy? It is again, we can liken it to Industry 4.0. What is it? Current state of industry plus Internet of Things, big data, smart sensors, data analytics, mobile devices, robots, additive manufacturing, digital simulation tools, machine learning, deep learning, machine-to-machine communication, machine-to-human interface, whatever. Then what is smart energy? The current state of energy plus all these things. That is, look at the Industry 4.0, okay? And you can understand what Energy 4.0 will be. Okay, is this a theory or is it something serious? I think it is very serious. Even the US Department of Energy, last year about this time, they asked for a report, okay, the Energy Ministry, on artificial intelligence, okay? And here are the 5 preliminary recommendations. DOE-wide AI capability, that is Department of Energy, should have artificial intelligence capability in everything, okay? And the data problem, I will discuss it in a few minutes. Workforce development, the new workforce, okay? Will have to have the necessary skills to be functional in this new environment. Regulator function, obviously you will need new regulations there in this new environment. And cybersecurity. It will come with challenges, okay? So right now, these are the 5 areas that the Department of Energy identified as something that they should concentrate on, because this is the future. And unless you get ready for the future now, then when these realities hit you like a big wave, okay, then you cannot be functional there, you cannot survive. And now we have the new data economy, okay? And data is used for description, diagnostics, prediction, and prescription of solutions, okay? And problems. Unless you have the data, okay? You cannot do anything. We depend on data. And data right now is being generated at an ever-increasing rate. And data scientists, they are becoming the most important people. And many universities are starting, you know, degree programs in data science, sometimes a certificate program, sometimes a master's, whatever. So it may be good for you also if you can do a minor in data science, because it is unavoidable there. and those who control the data, process the data, and make sense out of the data, they will have the advantage in this competitive environment. And navigating the data economy is becoming the new challenge here. And the data-driven approaches, they are becoming more and more valuable because our ability to store large amounts of data and the computational power to crunch through this data, okay, and the advanced analytics to make sense out of data, it is growing, okay? So in the future, we will see more of these. And these opportunities have led to the development of major facilities for aggregating, analyzing, and monetizing data. It is not like, you know, for the sake of gathering data. In the end, you convert it to economic gain there. For example, GE, Atlanta facility in the US, GE is like 200 billion data points live, okay, from 5,000 generating power plants in over 60 countries. And they use this data to detect anomalies, to increase reliability, and to improve efficiency. They do this through machine learning and data analytics. That way, they can, let's say, fix a problem before it becomes a full-fledged problem. And they can make money this way, okay, probably right now, than selling new things. So now I think the nature of businesses are changing. It is becoming like, you know, more service oriented. Same with this truck. This is a Volvo truck here, okay? And okay, what do you do here? Again, you know, the old truck plus Internet of Things sensors and a processor, a software. You have a smart truck, okay? Interconnected truck. This truck, you know, sends data for troubleshooting and analysis. And the software is updated automatically. It generates millions of data. Okay, and the result is the repair time is down by 25%. Okay, which means fewer service disruptions and more profits. It just, you know, a truck. If that's you can do this with a truck this way, make it, you know, more economical using data and artificial intelligence here. Okay. You can imagine what the future is holding for us. And also keep in mind that unless you make sense out of data, okay, that data is useless. Therefore, data processing, okay, and to generate patterns and to make sense out of those patterns is very important. And it is done through artificial intelligence. As humans, we are not that fast. We cannot do it, okay? We can do it with a few, but let's say with millions of, you know, patterns there, okay, you will have to use the artificial intelligence to really sort them out and then concentrate on the ones that you think are critical. So this way, you know, we gain more insight about the operation. We make the planning, we reduce the operational costs. Not only that, we also reduce catastrophes because any accident normally shouts that the accident is about to occur, but we don't see it with this eye. If let's say you have all the sensors and the data acquisition systems and the processing power in place, okay, then I think you can learn about it in advance and interfere in a timely manner there. Now data is good and it is becoming the big business right now, but it also has the dark side, okay? There are challenges are facing data economy. For example, who owns the data? You know, you see all the fights, right? Right now, you know, Facebook, WhatsApp, you know, whatever, they are collecting data about, let's say, your usage habits from the computer, okay? So let's say, do you own this data or do they own it or what? And then what is the nationality of the data? Is it Mexican or Colombian or US or what? And then how secure is the data? Can you protect it? Okay. And gaining access to data, to democratize data. How can you create value from data? Obviously, there is an expense here and you will have to monetize it. Can you, let's say, generate money from this data? And cybersecurity, can you safeguard it? And can you protect the privacy? Okay, people do their best, but obviously not. For example, in a few years ago, the Ukrainian power grid, okay, it led to power outages, and the reason was a cyber attack. That is, you may have your smart grid, but it comes with risks, okay? If, let's say, you want to reap the advantages of artificial intelligence, you will have to develop also good cybersecurity measures there. Even, let's say, the electric cars, now they are becoming, you know, more and more common. Okay, they are selling like a few millions every year. And since they are also connected to the grid, that means some people may, the hackers may attack the grid through the electric cars. And here's a study which says that, you know, we should really be careful. That is, the electric cars may pose a danger for the electric grid there. So we will have to, you know, put the preventive measures in place. So cybersecurity, I think, is important right now. It will be more important in the future there. Let's say in our energy field, even the simple thermostat that you may have in your house, okay, they learn. They look at your usage habits, okay, and then they may sense even the activity level there. You can program it or you can let it learn. So that's simple device. Has, you know, a little brain of its own, which makes some of the decisions there. And let's say using some coatings, okay, we may have, let's say, like a 70% more energy efficiency in buildings, okay, in the summer, okay, by simply using artificial intelligence there. That is measuring the temperature and then adjusting the transmissivity there, okay? If it is cold, then you let more sunlight in, you change the color. If it is hot, you make it dark, so that the solar energy doesn't enter that much. It saves you air conditioning there. And the whole thing is done automatically. That is software and algorithm does it. And motion sensor, this is the simple thing, okay? Can sense a few things and then can adjust whether to air condition a place or not, simply by sensing the activity level. If there's no activity, it shuts it off. And let's say major buildings, okay, you may have complicated buildings. And right now we are looking at these huge buildings again as a live organism. Let's say in our human body, we have like 37 trillion cells, okay? But they work as one. And this building may have, you know, thousands of rooms, I don't know, other places there, shops, whatever. I think if the human body can do it, we should be able to do that for the building. That is, by using an artificial brain, we can, let's say, make every single room comfortable and energy efficient. As a result, we can get savings of 40% and also be more comfortable. That's the comfort level can be like, you know, 60% there. And let's say this is another approach in HVAC systems. They claim like energy efficiency of 50%. That is, they provide the same comfort level using half of the energy there, okay? And it involves minimal human intervention. And right now, appliances are being connected to the internet. In the future, we will see more of these. In fact, you may even connect, let's say, your air conditioner, okay, to the internet. During the peak times, you may sign a contract saying that, okay, you can turn my air conditioner off for up to 2 hours, for example, and then they may pay you, let's say, money which is well above the regular price of electricity. Okay, and the power company will not have to run a new power plant. So things of this kind, okay? Let's say the street lights, again, adjusting to the traffic, adjusting to the need, to the light situations, whatever. And they claim like they can save 65% of the energy used to light the streets there. How? Again, through intelligent lighting and artificial intelligence. Even let's say wind turbines, by simply using artificial intelligence, okay, the prediction or the weather, the statistics, whatever, okay, then let's say you can sell the power in advance at the best prices. You can adjust the turbo blades automatically, okay, and I think you can make your system more efficient that way. Even let's say we can well have like innovation and artificial intelligence in business models, combining renewable energy, energy storage, and then what energy usage, okay? Using again, contracts or protocols there. Again, the solar, wind, all interconnected there, okay? For example, in this system, we have like 50,000 homes, okay? There are PVs on the roofs and then they are interconnected. And there is no charge to the households, and the households, they get like 30% savings from electricity, okay? Which is not bad. And then they also have a Powerball battery in each house. They serve as storage devices, all distributed. The end result is everybody wins. You as a homeowner, the company that builds this system, the environment, because now you can use the solar energy, okay? Even during the night, because you have storage there. And you can, let's say, use the storage for peak times, when the power is expensive, kind of do the peak shifting there, et cetera. Right now the batteries, I think we see more and more of them. The battery storage, again, very simple, no moving parts, and the cost has come down sufficiently that they are replacing gas turbines right now. Instead of building new natural gas power plants, which is the norm for peak power generation, right now we have simply battery storage there. We have, let's say, again, a huge investments in this. For example, a 1200 megawatt storage system, $2.5 billion, okay? This will be the largest in the world. And we will see more of these, I think, everywhere in the world there. Even let's say your car, let's say you bought an electric car. Normally, you spend money on electricity because electricity is not free. But in the future, as these devices become more and more common, these cars, okay, what will happen is, usually you come home at, let's say, 6, 7, and then some earlier. The time period, between 6 and probably 10, when everybody is at home, okay, using all the power, it is the peak time. So what you can do is you can authorize the power company to draw power from your battery at a high price. And the end result may be the electricity in your car may end up being free, okay? And then after, let's say, 12 midnight, your car will be charged when electricity is the cheapest, okay? So you can kind of see the savings there. Same with batteries at home. We used to have, small engines. When power goes out, they run on gasoline or diesel fuel, noisy, okay? And they pollute the environment. Now batteries, they charge enough electricity to be enough for one day, okay? But that means, you can use that device to charge at night when electricity is cheap, and then use it during the day, at least during the peak hours, when electricity is the most expensive. Again, how do you do this? You don't want to get involved in this, right? So what you do is you simply you simply use the software, the artificial intelligence, so that the systems are, the decisions are done automatically there. Okay, so in the future, we will need engineers who are equipped with technical literacy. That is, the technical knowledge is, of course, important. Data literacy, so that, you know, they can make sense out of piles of data. AI literacy, they can, let's say, manage and even design artificial intelligence and troubleshoot the software. Human literacy, such as teamwork, entrepreneurship, creativity, and ethics, and integration ability. That is, as engineers, you know, these traits here, you will feel like you will need these all the time. Therefore, you need to go beyond what you learn, you know, in classrooms and be equipped with these skills here. For example, the electric vehicle manufacturers, okay? They need engineers with artificial intelligence and robotic skills. So whether you are a mechanical engineer or electrical engineer or software engineer, you will have to learn, you know, some of these. You will have to know the, you know, some circuitry, some code writing. At least, you know, when you look at the code, you can kind of see if there is a problem there. Otherwise, if the software engineer doesn't understand the mechanical and electronic systems there, I think we have a very dangerous situation there. And unless we understand what they are doing, we speak to each other and understand each other, then I think artificial intelligence, just like the Airbus 737, okay, will have, you know, problems there. Therefore, you will have to learn, you know, things from other disciplines. If you are an electrical engineering student, maybe, you know, from some mechanical, some controls, some, I don't know, software, and mechanical engineering student, again, you know, some sensors, controls, you probably learn, and then some coding, artificial intelligence, whatever there. And ASME, the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, they did a survey, and the result is companies are looking for mechanical engineers, with experience in additive manufacturing, robotics, computer and electrical engineering, mechatronics, system networking, and Internet of Things, okay? And normally we don't teach these things in many curriculums for mechanical engineers, but this is the real world. This is how the business world, the real world is evolving. Therefore, the education also should follow suit, okay? Even if they say these are not required in your curriculum, you will have to do your best as a student to acquire this knowledge and skills there, okay? And now we have the concept of T-shaped engineer. Now we have the people like, you know, apple-shaped, the pear-shaped people, and then apple-shaped, you know, people. Now we have T-shaped engineer. Why T? Because here, let's say, you need to have some depth, at least in one discipline, okay? That is, again, you should choose something like, you know, mechanical, chemical, electrical, whatever. Have a discipline. And then within that discipline, choose a system, okay, to be expert on. It can be, let's say, robotics, it can be energy, it can be control, whatever, okay? That is a discipline and a system. And on top of that, you will have to understand many disciplines, okay, and many systems. You should be able to understand them and to have discussions over them and communicate on those systems there. And on top of it, you will have to have the boundary crossing competencies like teamwork, communication, networks, critical thinking, global understanding, project management, etc. So this is common for all disciplines, all systems, okay? So I think this is the challenge that you are facing as the engineer of the future. It is not like, you know, you just take some courses and graduate, or, you know, the best jobs that are waiting for you. It is not that way. You will have to acquire these skills to be ready for the new world there. And you hear about the, you know, 21st century skills for all the people. What are those? Well, depends on who you are listening to, but I think communication usually tops the list. So in this, you know, century, communication is very important. Again, critical thinking, problem solving, learning how to learn, research skills, ICT literacy, I don't know, initiative taking, creativity, even finance literacy, that you should really know enough about the economics, finance, management, whatever. You will need those, no matter what you do. Because in the end, at the minimum, you will be a project manager. And that means you will have to be conscious of, you know, the cost, okay, and other things there. And right now, the augmented and virtual reality, they are also being incorporated into everything. Normally, they were in education, in medicine, and to some degree in retail and construction, okay? But right now, we see them everywhere. Therefore, if let's say you acquire the skill of augmented reality, let's say incorporating this into a real system, it may be a system that you know very well as an engineer, okay? Hey, you know that that's a new product. And that means you are a unique person now. You can incorporate augmented reality, okay, into something real. Just that ability will open a lot of doors for you. Because of the changing environment, okay, disciplines are changing. I think mechanical engineering, okay, is really evolving into mechatronics engineering. Why? Because we need more of artificial intelligence, okay, virtual reality, augmented reality, sensors, controls, electronics, cybersecurity, connectivity, coding, whatever. These are usually a part of your mechatronics. So mechanical engineering, okay, will not be the same in the future. It is already changing. Probably the change will be faster in the future. Even the simple refrigerator, okay, it also has many of these things here. Okay, we are coming to the end. Now you may also get scared, you know, artificial intelligence, you know, robots being smart. And now can they outsmart us? There is some talk like in 2040, but let's say 20 years from now, there will be a singularity. The machines will be smarter than human beings. So they pose an existential threat. That is, they will take over the world. The Tesla CEO Elon Musk strongly believes that, calls for regulation. But most experts disagree. I also disagree. I don't think there is any such danger. Why? Because artificial intelligence, okay, it doesn't have consciousness. It cannot have consciousness. It is simply mechanical parts with software, okay, circuitry there. It is not aware of itself, nothing. Okay, consciousness is a human trait, and imagination, as I mentioned before, okay? Imagination, creativity, a human trait. Initiative, taking, let's say, initiative. Okay, this is not that there's something, you know, you can build into software or something. Okay, and out-of-box thinking, and also inspiration. You know, we say, I got a great idea. These are all human traits. AI machines, the most intelligent robots or devices, they are zombies. They don't know what they are doing, and they will never know what they are doing. This is the dominant opinion right now. Some people, you know, think differently. Let me finish with this example and also some assessment. For example, GE is a major energy company, and the chief technology officer, Danielle Merfeld, her view on digitization of energy at GE, what are they doing on the smart energy part? And she says the strategy on energy investments, cross-cutting and next generation technologies that can benefit the broadest possible grouping of product teams, okay? Because AI is a cross-cutting technology. Once you develop it, technologies of this kind, okay, You can apply it to anything. And then the features that will be integrated in their existing products. Again, the product should be affordable, reliable, accessible, and sustainable. Okay, it will require some change. And the key digital trends transforming the energy sector. Number one is controls. That is, everything will have more brain, okay? And any asset will be like software-defined asset. This is what AI does. And predictive maintenance, for example, will be the result of it. And additive manufacturing, okay? Right now, maybe it is small, but we will see more and more of it in all sectors there. And the outcome of digital transformation of energy industry is cost effectiveness, sustainability, and reliability, and also being transformative across every area there. That way, you know, you have a unity and a common platform. Okay, now let me also, this is the last slide, finish with this one. Of course, you are wondering, you know, when I graduate, can I be, you know, successful, a good engineer, and also, of course, happy, right? Okay, we want to be successful, but if you are not happy, you know, what good is it? And the answer is really character, okay? Your personality. That is, everybody should spend time and energy on their personality, character, and soft skills. Kind of, you know, hone them to the point that, you know, you appear as very smooth, and I think very likable, and people want your company. Okay, they want to work with you. They want you in their team. Okay, how can you accomplish that? First, I think a strong, stable, positive, refined character. Okay, what does it involve? Positive personality, nothing, you know, secret here. Just be positive, okay? Have good intentions and empathize, be optimistic, be a energetic, lively person, be comfortable with yourself and with others, okay? And be a team player, easygoing, responsible, sharing, giving, okay? If the person next to you will, let's say, advance his or her career, let it be, you know, just take pride in it. That, you know, you get, you know, a share of that success there. Critical thinking, always questioning, searching for the better. Ethical behavior, doing the right thing, okay? Not because it is profitable, because it is right. And acting professionally. Be a problem solver, not a problem maker or problem transmitter. And be output based. Always question, what is the result? If, let's say, we do this, okay? What will change? What is the impact? Is it, let's say, worthwhile? Consider the potential or probable outcomes there. And acquire the 21st century skills, like communication, technology literacy, lifelong learning, creativity, innovation, entrepreneurship, leadership, perseverance, social intelligence, whatever. So keep in mind that the biggest asset of the smart companies and smart societies will always be natural intelligence, the human intelligence, but they should be supplemented with artificial intelligence, okay? One will not be without the other. Artificial intelligence by itself can do nothing. Imagine right now, we have a lot of smart devices. Take the human beings out of the world, okay? The world will stop. Okay, 100 years from now, again, the world will stop. So natural intelligence is always the key. But if, let's say, you enhance it with artificial intelligence, the more you do it, the more your natural intelligence will shine. You will be more effective, you will be more efficient, and you will be more successful and happy. And you will feel like you are making a meaningful contribution to the society and to the world. So with that, I thank you very much for your attention. So mucho gracias. And before I say adios, I think we will probably entertain some questions. So thank you very much for your attention.
Bueno, pues agradecemos muchísimo la conferencia que nos ha brindado el doctor Yunus Şengel. Y por supuesto, vamos a pasar a las preguntas que tienen las personas que hoy nos acompañan. Primero, déjenme comentarles, porque creo que esto es importante para el doctor, que nos acompañan hoy personas de muchas partes de Latinoamérica. Hay personas de Trujillo, Perú, de Quito, Ecuador, de Quetzaltenango y Ribera del Río de Guatemala, de Arauca, Medellín, Bogotá, de Colombia, de Honduras. Hay personas de Francia, de Granada, España, y de México. Nos acompañan de Guadalajara, Jalisco, Jocotitlán, Estado de México, Toluca, Estado de México, Ciudad de México, de Puebla, Puebla, de Tula de Allende, Hidalgo, Chihuahua, Chihuahua, Monterrey, Nuevo León, Tijuana, Baja California, Naucalpan, Estado de México, Zacatepec, Morelos, Mazatlán, Sinaloa, Coatzacoalcos, Veracruz, Morelia, Michoacán, Rosarito, Baja California y Atlacomulco, Estado de México. Pues como ve, doctor, una audiencia muy nutrida y todos para escuchar su magnífica conferencia. Y vamos a pasar ahora a las preguntas que tenemos el día de hoy de las personas que nos acompañan. Tenemos primero una pregunta de Rafael Morales Gamboa que nos dice, la voy a leer como él nos la escribió. Most forecasts are made for developed countries. What could be the difference, if any, for Latin American countries?
Okay, yeah, thank you very much. See, I live in Turkey right now, okay? I lived many years in the US. I retired from the US. I am from Turkey originally. And Turkey is also a developing country. So I can see the difference. You know, I lived maybe half my life in a developed country. The other half, including my childhood years and even my initial college years in Turkey. So I think I know the difference well. The opportunities, obviously, in developed countries are much better and bigger, okay? In developing countries, we face challenges there. But the impact that we create in developing countries is much greater because the skills that I mentioned, they are much needed. Let's say in Turkey right now, I am still doing a lot of work. In fact, I just finished work with a local geothermal power company, okay? And probably I spent like maybe a week on a project using my expertise here. Probably it will save them like a few million dollars every year. And we have more projects in line. And the same, let's say, with other companies in Turkey. Let's say I serve as an advisor to the energy ministry on some projects and other things. That is, in developing countries, the people with the skills and expertise, there are a lot of things. As for the young people, the students, you know, young engineers, et cetera, the opportunities, I think, are more limited. So my advice is, if let's say somehow you have, you know, good grades, you have good command of English, and I think you have, let's say, some projects which are impressive, you can still, I think, realize them in no matter where you live. It can be, you know, Ecuador, it can be Mexico or whatever, because the companies in your countries, same in Turkey, okay? They are looking for, I think, new projects, new ideas, new, I don't know, creative, you know, inventions, whatever. So the opportunities exist, but you will have to, you know the right people, talk to the right people. And even as, let's say you don't, as a student, okay, in a developing country, I am sure you do projects together, like, you know, solar car race or whatever, okay? Let's say do projects. It can be on anything. As a student, you can do this in any country. and I am sure it will attract our attention. You will develop a lot of these human skills, the soft skills that I mentioned, okay, from leadership to, you know, other things, to money management, budgeting, teamwork, communication, all those things. You acquire those skills, which are valuable, whether you live in your country or go to another country, doesn't matter. So those things you can still do. You can still, let's say, start your company. That is, if you, let's say, develop some good product as a student, as a team of, you know, students, you can start your startup company. And once, let's say, you show that you are doing something good, okay? I have no doubt that even if, let's say, you are in a developing economy, there is a lot of money there, a lot of resources, you will be noticed. That is, you don't need to live in a major developed country in order to have an impact. If you look at, let's say, the startup companies, let's say the major companies are buying. Okay, mm-hmm. Many are in developed countries, but some are in developing countries. And if possible, again, another advice, okay? If, let's say, you can do a master's or PhD in the US, in Europe, Japan, you know, whatever, I think it will be good for your personal development there. That is another option. But keep in mind that the conditions are different, opportunities are different, but no matter where you are in the world, okay, there are a lot of things you can do if you set your mind to it.
Muchas gracias, Dr. Schengel. Vamos con otra pregunta. Esta pregunta es de Ernesto Díaz y nos dice, how quantum computing could help industry and energy 4.0?
Can you repeat the question again, please?
Yes. How quantum computing could help industry and energy 4.0?
Oh boy, quantum computing. I think it can help anything. It will change the world because with quantum computing, you talk about, let's say, the speeds and capacity, which is unimaginable today. Therefore, imagine, let's say, the speeds and the capacity, which are millions of times more, okay? And the products that you can do with those things. Therefore, certainly AI will be not only to the next level, but next level. And probably, you know, we will talk to humanoids, you know, the machines that look like human beings, talk like, you know, all those things, okay? We cannot tell whether they are real human being or they are, let's say, a robot there. And this is the case, I think, in all fields. Energy, healthcare, finance, education, everything. I think the whole world will be changed. But again, I contend that nothing on consciousness, creativity, imagination, initiatives, whatever will change, because at the end, even if it is a quantum computing, it is still computing. It is still zeros and ones. Well, maybe they'll call it, you know, they call it qubits instead of, you know, right now, let's say, not the zeros and ones, but the basic thing will not change, but the capacity and the speed will change. Things, I think, will be, I think, much, much better, so much better that probably we cannot imagine right now. But quantum computing, also keep in mind, is just a tool. By itself, it cannot do anything. It will have to be incorporated in whatever we are doing. And I think the challenge for engineers in the future will be to take the capability of quantum computing and to incorporate it in whatever they are doing. Maybe the energy, healthcare, finance, you know, anything.
Excelente, muchas gracias. También de Ernesto Díaz nos pregunta, va relacionada, ¿Is quantum computing a tool for industry and energy 5.0?
Is quantum computing and energy 4.0? Can it be called 5.0?
A tool for industry 5.0. He's asking about 5.0.
Okay, now I would say these numbers, they mean something, but again, keep in mind that what is important is beyond the numbers. You know, in industry, first we have the, you know, steam power, then electric motors, automation, robots. Right now we have connectivity. Okay, it is the industry 4.0. Okay. And right now, let's say the human interaction, machine-human interaction, some people call this industry 5.0, okay? But most don't. That is still part of, you know, 4.0 there, okay? I use, let's say, the energy, the same numbering system to be, you know, compatible with what industry 4.0 or 5.0. So no matter what you call it, whether you call it 4 or 5, what is important is the content. Okay, right now the new emphasis is not only Internet of Things, machines are talking to each other, but also interacting with human beings. Okay, that is the devices with AI and humans with NI, natural intelligence, working together, some making, you know, some decisions, other making other decisions, maybe some decisions are made together. And this is becoming the new environment. It is in the future to be that way. And will it be called 4 still or 5? It doesn't really matter.
Excellent. Otra pregunta is, the artificial intelligence advances and applications presented suggest a future with even less human autonomy, average less decisions making. Are we building a society nervous system to take control of the social body?
If you can repeat the question again.
Yes, no problem. The artificial intelligence advances and applications presented suggests a future with even less human autonomy, average less decision making. Are we building a society nervous system to take control of the social body?
So in the future we will have, you know, smart devices, other things, and people, machines are interacting, working together, and with society 5.0, people will have to be, you know, functional in that environment. So it looks like the society will be very different. If you are watching, you know, some futuristic movies, okay, and let's say, you know, robots are doing this, humans are doing that, working together, whatever, okay, and those are futuristic movies kind of show us how the society in the future may look like. Of course, you know, we like watching those movies, but we don't have to be that way. But that they give us an idea as to how the society in the future will be. That is, we may have our, you know, personal assistant robot, each one of us in the family, kind of, you know, serving our breakfast, cooking our breakfast, I don't know. Taking our messages, like personal secretary, okay, personal servant, and we will argue mine is better than yours or something, and we will, let's say, go outside with our assistant, okay, as we see in the movies. I think we are getting close to that. That is, will they be that way, or will it be just a simple chip, okay, that we carry in our pocket? I don't know. But, you know, somehow the future looks very different. and the society will be very different. Right now we complain that we don't have much social interaction. Probably, you know, we will interact with our toys, you know, smart devices, and the human relations interactions probably will be almost a thing of the past. I hope not, but I think a different world is waiting for us.
Muy bien, tenemos pregunta de Rafael Morales. Él dice, would artificial intelligence never have consciousness?
Okay.
Imagination, ask, creativity?
Okay, if you ask different people, you will get different answers. Okay? So people have strongly different opinions on this. My opinion, okay, and the opinion of many AI experts, not all of them, is that artificial intelligence will never have consciousness. Because keep in mind that artificial intelligence is simply a code, a software, okay? It is what we create. It is simply a collection of commands. Do this, do that, whatever, even let's say deep learning. It is also a set of commands. Otherwise, build a chip with a few, let's say, you know, billions of circuits, leave it there, okay, that chip will do nothing. It needs, you know, some software to direct it to pass currents, you know, create kind of a selectively so that certain patterns will emerge, okay? And that software is created by the human being. And then you can direct it to change the software based on the inputs from the sensors and the overall, you know, criteria or command. That way the machines are learning, but they have no idea of what they are doing, what they are learning, and what they are feeling or anything, okay? This is blank. Although, you know, they can multiply a million numbers in a fraction of a second, this is blank. There is nobody up there. And if you look at, let's say, the nature of it, okay? Right now we have computers with the same number of circuits, same as the human brains, okay? Synapses, you know, whatever. Same way connected, okay? That is, we have artificial brains, equal capacity and electrical activity. You run it, what do you get? Nothing. Just, you know, circuits, electric circuits in a microprocessor. Electric signals do not generate consciousness, okay? That means the human being, we think, you know, the brain does it. My personal opinion, no. The brain does not do it, cannot do it. There is something beyond. Okay, and that beyond is beyond us. Therefore, the machines will never be like humans. They will never take initiative. They will never, let's say, think, and they will never not want to die. See, there are some movies like, you know, you take a computer to disassemble, and the robot, and robot is sad because, you know, they will kill the robot for parts. A robot will never feel that way. These are human traits. Imagination, same way. You can never build a machine, okay, who will imagine, make plans, okay? But you can, let's say, do a lot of coding so that, you know, it generates some solutions and kind of, you know, presents this to you, but it will have no idea as to what it is doing there. Therefore, you know, there are limitations. So this is my contention and the contention of many others, but keep in mind that Elon Musk doesn't think that way. He thinks that they will gain, you know, consciousness, they will pose an existential threat to humanity. So we need, you know, to take, you know, action right now. And many people also feel that way.
Muy bien. Gracias, doctor. Preguntan también, ¿qué opinión le merece la generación de entropía en las máquinas y procesos con la incorporación de la inteligencia artificial?
Okay, the first part of the question.
Claro. ¿Qué opinión le merece la generación de entropía en las máquinas y procesos con la incorporación de la inteligencia artificial?
Okay, the generation of entropy.
Yes.
When you say entropy, okay, entropy means a lot of things. Okay, in thermodynamics, entropy is very clear. It is related to energy. Okay, during, let's say, energy conversions, entropy is generated as a result of imperfections in the conversions of energy from one form to the other. Okay, therefore, the entropy definition, I think, since 1800s is that way. But entropy is also defined statistically, and it is now used in information science as to do what is known and what is not known, and how much, let's say, is knowable, whatever, in statistics. So entropy is used, I think, in a lot of fields, including economics. I think we all agree that entropy generation is bad, okay? But sometimes they claim, like, you know, if you look at the entropy as in association with information science, that information is conserved. A lot of, I think, right now talk about entropy in different fields, nothing to do with the entropy in thermodynamics, which is, I think, the correct way, correct area of usage of entropy there, okay? That entropy creates disorder in the universe, okay? For example, if let's say we use fuel to do something, some work here, to drive our cars or to generate electricity, whatever, since that process is not perfect, we have to generate entropy. So the entropy of the world is increasing. So we are continually moving into a universe with more entropy, okay? That is, entropy creation is continual process. And at the end, we will simply reach, I think, minimum exergy and maximum entropy to the point of unsustainability. It is the reason that it is important to have, you know, energy efficiency, to use a renewable energy, because unless we use the wind, it will be wasted anyway. At least we can save some of it to reduce the entropy generation there. But as for the, let's say, artificial intelligence, thermodynamically doesn't create any entropy, doesn't generate any entropy, except some electric current there is converted to heat, which is, you know, compared to the entropy generation associated with other energy conversion processes, okay? It is really nothing. Therefore, the contribution of artificial intelligence, because of the electricity it uses and converts to heat, which generates entropy, compared to other generations of entropy, is really minimal. Therefore, I'll say, you know, insignificant.
Muchas gracias, doctor. Y bueno, vamos a compartir con usted una última pregunta por una cuestión de tiempo simplemente. La verdad es que hay muchas preguntas y veremos la manera de hacérselas llegar a usted para que nos haga favor de responderlas y después compartirla con nuestra audiencia en otro momento. La última pregunta es de Guillermo Domínguez y dice, "Thank you so much for sharing your ideas with us. Also, your talk is oriented to engineering. Could you share with us a reflection on the application of artificial intelligence in the management of companies?"
Can you repeat the question? The connection somehow was very bad on that one, yeah.
Yes. No problem. Also, your talk is oriented to engineering. Could you share with us a reflection on the application of artificial intelligence in the management of companies?
Okay. Oh, yeah. Right now, even the managers, CEOs, many of them are using artificial intelligence in their decision making. The reason is that they let's say need to make decisions, and important decisions. And the manager can be the manager of an engineering company, and then it can be the manager of a financial company. It may be manager of a service company, whatever. But the decisions must be based on data, and analysis of data. The raw data, and the more the data, the more the knowledge, the better. But keep in mind that raw data is not knowledge. You may be getting a lot of inputs, and it takes time to absorb it and to process it, to classify it, and then to pass judgment on it. What artificial intelligence does is, if let's say you feed all this data to a program, artificial intelligence, a software, so that it collects the data, it recognizes the patterns, kind of reduces the data, and then assembles the data in a meaningful way, filters the data as needed, and then feeds you information, enough information, which captures the core of all the inputs, and then gives you meaningful information, enough for you to understand, to see the whole picture, and then to process it yourself and to make a decision. This is what AI does. Therefore, all the managers, in order to be a good manager, and to make the good decisions, they need to do that. Otherwise, they will make decisions based on limited data, limited information, and the result, may not be the best decision there, because let's say a computer can make 1 million multiplications in 1 second, can see, let's say, 1 million data in 1 second, but as humans, we can see only this much, 5 or 10, so something will have to reduce it to this many, data bits, which are meaningful and also comprehensible. Then, I can, let's say, pass a judgment, put, some weights on it, what is important, what is not, whatever. And then it represents, let's say, the entire, hopefully, the data out there. So artificial intelligence, I think it is really becoming a must for managers. Not a luxury, but a must. And another nice thing is, if I can gather the information in, let's say, 5 minutes instead of 5 hours, so that I can make an informed decision, that means I can spend the other time on, creative things as to the, direction of the company, for example, or just, relax and clearing your mind, and then talking to the employees, to other people, or whatever. That way, you become not only more productive, more efficient, but also a healthier and much better manager there.
Excelente. Muchísimas gracias, Dr. Schengel. Pues yo simplemente voy a cerrar la presentación de su conferencia. Pues agradeciendo a los docentes y estudiantes que estuvieron conectados hoy de las siguientes universidades. La UNA de Honduras, el Instituto Tecnológico de Ciudad Victoria en México, Colegio Internacional Montessori, FESCO Autitlán de la UNAM, Universidad Tecnológica de Jalisco, Universidad Distrital Francisco José de Caldas en Colombia, Universidad Pontificia Bolivariana de Colombia, Universidad Mariano Gálvez de Guatemala, Fundación Universidad de América de Colombia, TEC de Monterrey, Campus Ciudad de México, la UPI, Universidad Tecnológica de Altamira, México, Universidad Tecnológica del Valle de Toluca, México, Universidad Autónoma de Nuevo León, México, Tecnológico de Monterrey, Campus Puebla, Tecnológico de Estudios Superiores de Jocotitlán, México y el ITESO de Guadalajara. Muchas gracias a todos ustedes por su presencia. Haremos llegar las preguntas que quedaron pendientes y felicitaciones al doctor Schengel para que las reciba. Y pues nuevamente, doctor Yunus Schengel, le agradezco infinitamente a nombre de McGraw-Hill el que haya... nos haya dado el honor de escuchar su conferencia el día de hoy y haya estado cerca de nuestros profesores, estudiantes y también, bueno, pues de todos los que trabajamos en McGraw-Hill.
And I thank you very much also my appreciation to McGraw-Hill for arranging this conference, this multinational. This is our first for me to be addressing, you know, so many young people from so many different countries. And organizing such things, you know, takes a lot of time and energy. So I appreciate McGraw-Hill doing that. I also wish all the young people, young students, the best in their future. I think close your ears to the negatives, concentrate on the positive. No matter what, the world is a very good place, okay? And life is very good. Enjoy life. Do your contribution, and I think in the future, the world that you will live in will be a much, much better world in many ways, including the technological way there. So enjoy life and enjoy your success and be happy and good. I thank you very much. Mucho gracias to all of you.
Muchas gracias a todos. Perdón, Gaby.
Adelante.
No, muchas gracias a todos por esta excelente presentación del doctor Schengel. Realmente le agradecemos demasiado su tiempo. A ti, Gaby, también. También a nuestra compañera Gaby, la que nos ayudó a traducir todo. Y les invitamos a seguir nuestras redes sociales para que estén al pendiente de nuestras próximas sesiones, próximos eventos. También está mi correo por si tienen alguna duda de esta sesión, alguna pregunta que nos alcanza a llegar para hacérsela llegar al doctor Schengel. Mil gracias, Gaby. Así que te dejo los micrófonos.
Muchas gracias a todos nuevamente. Gracias a McGraw-Hill por traernos el día de hoy a Dr. Schengel. Gracias, Eric, por toda tu organización. Marisol, a todas las personas en McGraw-Hill. Gracias nuevamente, Dr. Schengel. Hasta pronto y muy honrados con su presencia.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay. Adios.